Good evening and welcome everyone to the National Infrastructure Bank Coalition's Thursday evening webinar series. We're so appreciative to all of you for taking time from your schedules to attend this session. My name is Julie Olson. I'm a business person out of the Pacific Northwest, the chair of the Progressive Caucus for the Alaska Democrats, and a board member for the National Infrastructure Bank. We have a great lineup of experts here to speak tonight about the National Infrastructure Bank, and we are very excited to have them. But first, before we go to our panel of experts, I want to give you a couple of updates. We're calling this session, we're calling 2023 the year of the National Infrastructure Bank. And here, only 2.5 weeks into 2023, we have a couple of great updates for you. First of all, we've had a resolution introduced into the Washington State Senate with 16 co-sponsors. So we view this very positively, and we're very hopeful that it will get through the legislature and be approved this session. And we've also had the resolution introduced into the New York City Council. As some of you may know, the Los Angeles City Council approved a resolution supporting the National Infrastructure Bank last year, and we are thrilled to see New York City doing the same thing. So we have a lot of momentum going already, and we're looking forward to seeing great things happen in 2023. So with that, I'd like to go to our first speaker, Alfeka Mutardi. She's the macroeconomist for the National Infrastructure Bank Coalition, a former economist with the International Monetary Fund. And I think you'll find her presentation very interesting. Alfeka?
Great. Thank you very much, Julie, and welcome to all of you. I understand we have a few new folks on the call tonight, especially Colorado is in the house. I do want to give you an update on where we stand with our National Infrastructure Bank bill. So I'm going to do a little bit of review. Apologies for some of you who have seen some of these slides before, but I wanted to let you know where we are. Our bill in Congress, H.R. 3339, before it expired at the end of last year, we were able to bring on 20 co-sponsors onto this bill. And a large chunk of these co-sponsors came on after the bipartisan law was passed into law and everybody realized that it was going to be too small to do the whole job. And especially as legislators in different states came and talked to their members of Congress and convinced them that we need this bank and this bill to build up all of our nation's infrastructure. It'll create a $5 trillion public bank to lend for infrastructure projects all across the country. And I wanted to give a real quick review on how the bank works. It uses the Hamiltonian method to get itself started. It goes to the private sector who are holding treasuries and ask them would they like to sell in a small portion of them into the NIB in exchange for preferred stock that would pay these investors a little bit extra. In exchange for this guarantee, they would be silent partners. They would be holding preferred stock and they would be silent partners in the bank, but they would get a guaranteed extra rate of return that would come out of or be paid out of the interest earnings from the NIB's loans. Plenty of money left over to meet the bank's other operational needs. That is, this bank is self-sustaining and doesn't require infusions from a budget to get it started. And then that capital will sit on the bank's books, acts like a rainy day fund. All banks are required to maintain capital of $1 in capital to $10 in loans they give out. So that's how we capitalize the bank. And this is how the bank actually gives out a loan. It works exactly like a commercial bank, uses the same accounting software and everything that a commercial bank uses. Each time the NIB creates and books a loan, it creates a deposit on the other side of its books. It's a feature of its automatic accountancy methods. And then when you create a deposit, you're actually adding to the nation's money supply. And then it uses cash on hand coming in from other deposits to move money out of this deposit and circulate it around into the rest of the banking system. So that's the loan process. The loan terms will be very advantageous. This is a public bank. We want to keep financing costs to a bare minimum. So the bank would be charging around the treasury bond rate for interest charged and flexible repayment terms. And then borrowers would be any state or local government entity, including a cooperative or a housing authority that can come in directly to the NIB and request a loan for the project that it wants to get financed. We'll cover $5 trillion in projects over a 10-year period. We know that we have this need from the American Society of Civil Engineers, who have estimated that's how much we need over the next 10 years in additional new money above and beyond what budgets are providing now to repair our transportation systems, our water systems, and upgrade our electric power grid. In addition, we added a few categories of our own we think are also critical: a complete high-speed rail network all across the country, broadband everywhere to get this out into rural areas and underserved urban areas, and affordable housing. We're the only bank that we know of, or the only source of financing we know of, that will fund 7 million new affordable housing units. And by that, we mean housing units that are targeted to the very lowest income earners who need them the most. And then large-scale water projects to address drought in the Southwest, where we grow half of our nation's food supply. So let me just give you one example of how this might work for a given state. And I'll choose Colorado just to give you an example. We want to fix all the local roads in that state. We want to make sure that we fix all the bridges, put in new water systems where they've reached their lifetime of their usefulness. We want to make sure that the electric power grid is hardened. We want to build out high-speed rail to connect the cities all along the Front Range to each other to promote economic growth. We want to get broadband out everywhere, affordable housing. The state needs at least 300,000 new affordable housing units, and we can build that as well. And then we want to make sure we take care of the Colorado River system, which is providing electricity and water distribution to 40 million families in 7 different states, and it is running bone dry. So we have a proposal, just one of the things that this $400 billion in dollop of money can finance is a project to take water from a river, an offshoot river of the Mississippi called the Atchafalaya, and pump it all the way up into the Colorado River Basin and fill up those aquifers really quickly. That's just one example. So what we know is that our bill is 10 times larger in terms of providing new money than the bipartisan infrastructure law that passed last year. Every single state will not be able to get everything that it needs from the bipartisan law to fix its roads and bridges and build up its transit systems and fix all that water infrastructure. We're going to need the National Infrastructure Bank to top up the other 90% of the financing that's still missing from the financing picture. And there's one more thing. We could be heading into a recession in 2023. Some of our other speakers are going to talk more about this, but already we've seen signs that we're heading into the recession. We've seen stock market crashes. Inflation is falling down. Manufacturing is way off from its peak in 2021. Even though we have a tight labor market, we still have a lot of folks that are out of work. And just yesterday, the Federal Reserve announced that it will continue to raise interest rates in this coming year, maybe up as high as 5 or 5.5% for the money that it lends to banks to on-lend, and hopes that rates will stay there. It wants to really clamp down on demand. It thinks that's the way to solve inflation. We think that's the wrong idea because it's going to crush small and medium businesses. It's going to torpedo again local finances. It could even disrupt the banking sector. And we've already seen that the stock market and your 401ks are down. So we have another plan to use our National Infrastructure Bank to lean against this recession. How does that work? When more people become unemployed as a result of this reckless Fed policy, we can hire them into the National Infrastructure Bank, train them up, put them into apprenticeship programs so they earn while they learn right away, and build out all of our nation's infrastructure. We'll be hiring locally and training locally, and that'll provide jobs for people locally to fix our nation's infrastructure. So we want all of your help in getting this bill passed in 2023. Thanks.
Thanks, Alfeka. I do want to let everyone on the call know that if you want more details about how exactly the National Infrastructure Bank would work, you can go to our website where we have an extensive number of videos and information, the complete text of the bill, and that sort of thing. So please feel free or after the call to visit our website for more information. Next, I would like to welcome another one of our esteemed speakers, Dr. Nomi Prins, PhD, author, and former Wall Street executive from Los Angeles, California. Dr. Prins.
Thank you very much, Seeley. And Alfeka, you are so inspirational to all of us. I just want to let you know that we should run you for a major office, but that's another call. So what I want to do is take up a little bit from where Alfeka mentioned we wanted to discuss how you basically grow yourself out of the recession that we find ourselves potentially facing because of how aggressively the Fed has hiked rates in response to inflationary pressures, many of which has to do with supply chains, geopolitics, and a general lack of attention to infrastructure from the standpoint of transporting things from A to B, from building more efficient power plants, more energy clean grids, and so forth. There's a lot on the infrastructure side that is actually more expensive because we have not put that money into it over the years. And that's exactly what the National Infrastructure Bank is positioned to do, to look at those projects that get started with some seed money from the Bipartisan Infrastructure Act or from support or tax subsidies from the Inflation Reduction Act as well, and supplement that to actually get projects done, as opposed to having them started and wait, because that doesn't really help the economy. That just creates more of the problems that we have been seeing. But turning to the Fed a little bit more in terms of how it has effectively not cared about potentially not just throwing our country into a recession, but about a global recession in the world, and particularly with developing countries, as the World Bank just noted, who are expected to see less growth this year than in each of the 10 years preceding the pandemic. So basically slowing the ramp that they were already on. And why does that matter? Because a lot of the materials that we need or that we basically imported to create some of this infrastructure are now going to be coming from economies that are themselves suffering. And that has its own knock-on effect in terms of problems. Now, the Fed has aggressively, again, raised rates last year by an amount and in a period higher and shorter than they have ever done in the history of their existence since 1913. And the reason for that is because Fed Reserve Chairman Jerome Powell does not like the American worker. Now, there are other reasons for that. The ones that they say, which is fighting the inflationary pressures that have come up. The Fed did not care about inflationary pressures when stock buybacks were a major thing across corporate America in the wake of the financial crisis and the pandemic, when CEOs were and continued to be overpaid relative to the average worker, didn't care that those wages were inflating, cares that the average worker's wages might be going up a little bit and not even match the inflationary pressures of the prices of things that people actually need and buy on an everyday basis. However, that is where the Fed is right now. But it also gives us an opportunity to really push the National Infrastructure Bank today. And the reason for that is this: we also have a tremendous amount of debt. As we know, by turning on CNN or literally any other news station, there's a lot of squabbling going on. Not surprising, it is Washington, but in Washington, about the debt ceiling and about the fact that we're actually over the debt ceiling, about $31.5 trillion of debt right now, public debt in the United States, relative to a debt ceiling of $31.4 trillion. So we're arguing over something we've already surpassed, but there's little cosmetic reasons why that's still okay. But in that dramedy that is going on in Washington with respect to debt, we have an opportunity, I think, this year, which is another reason why 2023 will be the year of the National Infrastructure Bank, to say, look, let's just take a look at debt. Let's take a look at real economic growth. Let's take a look at really paying people to do jobs to affect that growth from the foundation of the economy, from local communities through states up to the federal level, and actually optimize all of it. Let's optimize the debt that we have already issued at these higher rates, for which the government is paying about $400 billion a year in interest payments alone. And let's rechannel that money, not just the interest payments that we have to pay, but some of the treasury bonds that have already been out there that are already issued, and let's rechannel it into funding, as every single bank on Wall Street does when they provide a loan, against the collateral of United States economic growth and US citizens and their wages and their work and their innovation and their advancement, not just for getting ourselves out of a report card in infrastructure that's currently at a C minus, up from a D plus, good, but at a C minus with respect to the infrastructure of our country today, up to, I don't know, let's say at least a B, but maybe even above that, because I don't know about all of you, but C minus, not a good grade. And we've been dealing with this for far too long. I also think this year, and this has changed a little bit since we were talking over the last year, we have an actual opportunity, yes, an opportunity with a different kind of Congress. Yes, even with the House turning towards the Republican side, to actually impact how we think of spending and how we think of investing, and to flip those two around and say that we're not actually spending money on growing the American economy. We are investing in the American economy. And here is a very efficient way to do that. And for the record, it is way more efficient and way more transparent in terms of how the National Infrastructure Bank will be created and monitored and presided over than anything the Fed is doing on any given day, at any given hour, and in any given minute. And so we have this opportunity, and I'm actually really excited about, to take all of that ideas behind the Bipartisan Infrastructure Act, between the reduction inflation, the Inflation Reduction Act, with the high debt that we have, with the just mismanagement of the Fed's own job by the Fed with respect to our economy and our workers that we have, and turn it all around and get those Congress people to continue to listen. And there's been tremendous work done, and it continues to be done, as Julie mentioned in the beginning of this call, and as we know from those of us who have been on here for a while, already there's just a lot of buy-in on both coasts. And so now the question is, taking every single set of the local supporters of infrastructure in local communities and in local governments, pushing it up and continuing to push it up, as we've already started to do, to all the states and to the national government, and to get this bill done.
Thank you so much, Nomi. Really appreciate you being here. Next, I would like to go on to Ellen Brown, who is the chair of the Public Banking Institute in Los Angeles, California. There's really been a huge amount of growth and interest in public banking around the country, and I think Ellen will be able to give us some updates on that movement. Ellen?
Okay. So as Nomi points out, we've hit our debt ceiling. You can see from this chart, we've actually been there before. This is a debt to GDP chart in that World War II, and we got out of it by bringing GDP, not by paying off the debt, but by bringing GDP up to meet the debt. And that was done largely through the Reconstruction Finance Corporation, which is the model for what we're doing hopefully with this bank. But we need because of the debt ceiling crisis, we need some sort of workaround. And that's what the Reconstruction Finance Corporation did. We've actually been in this situation a number of times before in our national history, starting with the American colonists, who didn't have their own monetary system. And they managed to escape the British colonial system by issuing their own money. This was called, and issuing their own credit, and this was called the American system versus the British system. The colonists actually won the Revolutionary War, funded with paper continentals. Like, they didn't really have money. As Benjamin Franklin said, isn't it amazing that we actually won this war just with paper money? But the problem was, the paper was supposedly backed by the anticipation of tax revenues, and it was a lot easier to issue the money than to bring it back in tax revenues. Plus the fact that the British were heavily counterfeiting this paper money. It was a lot easier. It was easier to counterfeit then than it is now, obviously. So the continental got heavily deflated, or inflated and devalued. And the colonies, which were now the states, wound up $44 million in debt. So Alexander Hamilton, our first U.S. Treasury Secretary, did something very clever. He turned the debt into equity. So state debt was accepted in partial payment for stock in the first U.S. bank. The bank then leveraged this capital into credit, issued as the first U.S. currency. So then we had a national currency. The loans were based on the fractional reserve model established by the Bank of England. But the difference was the primary function of the Bank of the U.S. was to be to issue credit for internal improvements and other economic development, according to Hamilton's system of public credit. So it was a national development bank, and so was the second U.S. bank. Among other achievements during that period was the Erie Canal, but there was quite a bit more. After 1790, the economy grew rapidly. I don't have time to read all this, but included post offices, mileage of post roads, newspapers, corporations, turnpikes, bridges, canals, waterworks, banks, etc. Andrew Jackson shut the second U.S. bank down, and we had another depression, and President Lincoln was faced with a civil war where he's going to have to fund it with loans from British-backed banks at between 24 and 36% interest, so very high interest rates. And to avoid that, he reverted to the system of the American colonists and just printed the money. So he printed paper U.S. notes or greenbacks. And his government founded the national bank system. So before that, you had all these private banks that were issuing their own bank notes, which are promissory notes, supposedly backed by gold, but they frequently did not have the gold, sufficient gold to meet the withdrawals. And so it was a quite chaotic system. And the national bank system stabilized that, that in order to join it, you had to capitalize your bank notes with government debt. So the money from that and from the greenbacks funded not only the war effort, but rapid economic development. The most famous was the Transcontinental Railroad, which by 1869 had linked up both sides of the country, and it actually returned a profit to the government. A telegraph system was developed alongside the Transcontinental Railroad, and railroad track was expanded all over the country, freight tonnage, et cetera. Factories and agriculture boomed. Mechanization allowed agriculture to flourish. So you can see the reaping machine there, among many other developments. Factory output increased, harbor improvements increased, et cetera. But not all banks joined the national banking system, and the latter half of the century was plagued with banking crises. And we had a particularly bad one in 1906, which triggered or led to the Federal Reserve being established, supposedly to backstop the banks, but it didn't work out too well. We got the worst banking crisis and depression in our history in 1929 to 1933. So Roosevelt did the radical move of taking the dollar off the gold standard, which, I mean, if you think about it, if we tried to do that today, it just wouldn't happen. But if you're in a serious enough crisis, it does happen. Congress all of a sudden becomes much more amenable to going along with the program. So, and he also funded rebuilding the whole country and funded our participation in World War II through the Reconstruction Finance Corporation. And that's the model we're pretty much planning to copy with this National Infrastructure Bank. So they started out with a mere $500 million in capitalization, not a lot. They issued bonds, they lent or invested in the next 25 years over $40 billion funding the New Deal and World War II. So many, many achievements of the New Deal. I can't read all these, but Tennessee Valley Authority, Public Works Administration, Works Progress Administration, the Rural Electrical Administration, the Electric Home and Farm Authority, et cetera, various homes, lending corporations, and Fannie Mae, et cetera. And then it funded many projects directly, including the San Francisco Bay Bridge, which is the picture at the bottom, which you can't see very well, and the Pennsylvania Turnpike, which you also can't see very well, the one at the right, et cetera. And $30 billion was lent or invested by the RFC in for World War II into corporations leading the war effort, including or created and capitalized seven subsidiaries, including the Defense Plant Corporation, the Defense Supply Corporation, and the Rubber Reserve Corporation. The Defense Plant Corporation built 2,200 new factories, revamped the entire machine tool industry. The Rubber Reserve Corporation started this synthetic rubber industry at a time when we didn't have rubber. You can see these kids were collecting. Apparently you couldn't buy a car then because they weren't selling new cars because they didn't have the tires. And some examples of Defense Plant Corporation included oil pipelines, the Dodge Chicago plant to build aircraft engines, and the Willow Run Airplane Factory, which are pictured here. So that's the workaround we need, according to James Butkiewicz, who's professor of economics at the University of Delaware. The RFC was an executive agency with the ability to obtain funding through the Treasury outside of the normal legislative process. Thus, the RFC could be used to finance a variety of favored projects and programs without legislative approval. So that's what we need to do, go around Congress by funding the National Infrastructure Bank on the Reconstruction Finance Corporation model. I'm also, like Nomi, quite excited about this whole project. Thank you very much. That's all I got.
Thanks, Ellen. Really appreciate that. I would like to take a moment to point out that we also have on the call this evening Walt McRee, who's the chair emeritus of the Public Banking Institute. So there are actually moves afoot in multiple states at this time to create state public banks. So perhaps we'll have some time in the Q&A to further talk about the whole concept of public banking. Next, I would like to introduce an infrastructure policy expert who spent some years in Congress and then also has worked in localities on getting the financing to fund infrastructure projects. So I'd like to introduce and thank Greg Seeley. Greg?
Hi there. Good evening. Thank you so much. I am going to go ahead and share my screen here real quick. Let's see if I can make that work. Okay, and there we go. So thank you so much for the introduction. Greg Seeley here in Albuquerque, New Mexico. Among some of my previous roles, I was a congressional staffer for both a representative and one of our senators here in New Mexico. I recently spent time working for the mayor here in Albuquerque, New Mexico. I worked on my title was State and Federal Funding Coordinator, a position that was created, in fact, just to address the historic federal funding opportunities coming from the bipartisan infrastructure law and now the Inflation Reduction Act. So what I wanted to talk to all of you about tonight is some challenges that I've seen. While I think it's absolutely critical we address infrastructure and this supplement and funding is you know, historic and timely, the problem is in the details, in the implementation. The goals are great, but does it actually work for the folks who have to actually apply for and deploy this funding? And so, quick overview. I'm going to run through this part very quickly, but essentially bipartisan infrastructure law, $550 billion in spending over 5 years, mostly allocated to formula grant funding. For those who aren't familiar with the difference between formula and what are sometimes called project grants or discretionary grants, formula funding is based on criteria for your locality, whether it's your state, your city, population, poverty, other factors are put together in a formula and allocations are made based on that formula. Whereas discretionary competitive grants, again, sometimes called project grants, are applied for and they are meant to address specific projects. So you have to typically build benefit cost analysis, budgets specific to a single project. One of the major issues that I see with the Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act is the fact that most local governments are not built to operate on discretionary competitive grants. And this is actually a multifaceted thing, but they genuinely are not built for this. So many local governments, states, and local governments are scrambling to build capacity to try to go after this funding via discretionary grants. So the goals of the infrastructure bill were, again, very important for our country, from delivering clean water, repairing roads and bridges, prioritizing broadband and cyber defense, all very worthy goals and important goals. However, when we look at the implementation of these of this funding, you can see here the overall spending for the bipartisan infrastructure law, the new spending, and then again, most of the funding is directed to each state. That's why they say our state is going to get $5 billion from the infrastructure bill. But for most local governments, including our hometown, much of the new federal funding that we are eligible for is in the form of these new funding streams, these new competitive grant programs. And here is an example of how federal grants to state and local governments have been changing over time. You can see there the 61% is all health, and most of that is the Medicaid program. So most of the money that comes from the federal government that's administered by state and local governments goes to healthcare. You can see there the transportation and then community and regional development, which is kind of everything else, is a sliver of how grants are spent from the federal government at the local and state level. So now with a larger amount of funding, I got my slides backwards, this one here. This slide here is what I call the funding wave. And this is if you look at the left side of it, 2023 is where we are right now. And over the next few years, this funding is going to peak. And you can see there the largest portion of that, roads, broadband, water, there's gonna be a major ramp up in that funding. So we're gonna have to address the issue of, if we don't have the capacity to capture funding now, even under the 2023 levels, how are we going to meet that 2027 level? In addition, a major issue with this bill and the implementation of it at the ground level is serious workforce shortages. In states like ours, where we're going to have to train many, many folks to try to even spend this money, even if we're successful in getting that funding, you can see here the kinds of jobs that are going to be needed just to be able to deploy those infrastructure projects. And again, these are in thousands, so 345,000 new jobs. Quite the obstacle. For example, let's say you secure money to do a road project. How many road crews in your state are available to do major road projects, especially when the state has its own formula funding for infrastructure that they're deploying? So they're already booking all those crews up for many, many months to come. Even if you're lucky enough to win a discretionary grant, can you deploy that money? And do you have the workforce to be able to spend it on? So we're a year in from the implementation of the law. And recently the White House put out an announcement with progress thus far. And this is the amount of spending announced to date in each of those states. And I would encourage folks to go to bill.gov and check out this map. What I did is I went and pulled the Excel sheets that actually have the underlying data in it and looked at project by project. What is that for my state, $2.1 billion that they're talking about? Because I'm not aware of that much funding being deployed yet in our state. And I think one of the key things here is to notice the word announced, because that funding is absolutely not gone out the door yet, nor has it been committed yet. It's just been announced. So far different than actually having deployed that funding in your state. This is aspirational. These are what we call vanity metrics in my line of work. So that being said, the devil's in the details. I encourage folks to go look at their individual states' tables. Those Excel sheets are very telling. I'm going to talk a little bit further about some of the challenges we face, and I won't read all of this to you, but what I will tell you is that at the ground level, in many local governments, what the way that municipal development departments are built, the way that capital improvement offices operate, they are already in many cases at max capacity. So what local governments often have to do is they have to develop and pay for on-call services. You hire engineering firms, architecture firms, and specialty consulting groups that help you to develop those projects and write those grants, do the design work, all that kind of stuff. So many local governments, again, just aren't designed to be able to deploy the infrastructure bill the way it is set up now. Many of these challenges, if you go through them line by line, are exactly the benefits, the kind of benefits that a long-term, stable national infrastructure bank, the problems that a national infrastructure bank would solve. Because again, to try and meet this big wave, right, and then have that funding drop off creates a need to change the way you do business and scramble to try and meet that requirement to capture that funding. Whereas with a long-term national infrastructure bank, the kind of capacity and technical assistance issues that come around are going to be a day-to-day operation of a national infrastructure bank. So lastly, I just want to point out that last line there about local governments. Requirements, many local governments have to apply through their State Department of Transportation to be a sub-recipient. What this does is it creates conflicts between neighboring communities. We need it for our roads. No, we need it for our roads. And it actually creates a problem there where, again, a national infrastructure bank would be able to prioritize those requirements. State Departments of Transportation are not necessarily designed to be able to do that at this point. Moving on, again, our state and local governments are where the action and the on the ground day-to-day work of government happens, right? Employ more than one of every seven workers, right? More than seven times as many as the federal government. 80% of all spending on roads, bridges, utilities, and other infrastructure, again, excluding federal grants, at the local government level. And even the White House has said 90% of the bipartisan infrastructure law funding will be deployed by non-federal partners. And in the past, too many communities have lacked the resources to apply for and deploy this funding. So the White House, recognizing that issue, put together a technical assistance guide, $700 million in funding, 65 technical assistance programs, which sounds wonderful and very impressive. The problem is that almost all of those programs are themselves competitive grants. So you have to win a competitive grant to get technical assistance to try to win competitive grants. It's actually another problem with, again, one-time funding designed not for how governments actually work. I pulled just a quick list of training for folks on the ground who have to administer federal aid grants, right? Folks think of grants as being most of the work up front is writing the grant. And while that's true, administering the grant is actually much bigger for most local governments. And so many departments you'll find, if you actually get someone to give you an honest answer, will say, you know what? No, thanks. I think we're good. We don't need a new grant. I don't have the manpower to support it. And that's because, just as an example, here's a list of some of the training modules. And I encourage folks who are interested to take a look at the Federal Aid Essentials for Local Governments website. Oh, and this is the list continued. Each and every one of these items is a module that you'd have to complete. This is 2-3 semesters worth of work if you were in a college class, right? So these things are not necessarily talked about at the higher levels. That at the local level, at the local government level, even for a government like ours here in Albuquerque, which the city of Albuquerque is a very substantial government, 6,000 people strong, and our mayor was able to hire a specialist to devote himself specifically to this funding, even we face major challenges in securing this money. So you can imagine what small and rural and historically underserved communities are facing. I put together some additional info, again, just trying to break down the difference between competitive and formula grant funding and new spending. I'll go ahead and stop right there. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Greg. That was extremely informative. And especially appreciate your comments about workforce development and preparedness. So that is something that's going to be extremely important when we get a national infrastructure bank created. And there are significant portions of our proposed legislation that deal with that and being able to provide the funding so that we will be able to train the high-skilled workers of the future to work on these investment projects. So really appreciate your time. Next, I would like to go with Assemblywoman Angela McKnight, who is a member of the New Jersey Assembly and is from North Jersey. As some of you may know, there are some very major infrastructure projects linking New Jersey and New York that people have talked about for decades, probably, and perhaps Assemblywoman Angela McKnight would be able to weigh in on that as part of her chat this evening. Angela?
Hi, good evening, everyone. Hope all is well. Thank you so much, Julie, for the beautiful introduction. And Greg, I was listening to your presentation and you've done a phenomenal job. So thank you so much for giving us a plethora of information. So I want to start off with the end result, right? So let's look forward to the end result. And a question goes to the end result is what's in it for me? So now I'm gonna move backwards. So if we allow the private sector to provide their funding to help fund this bank, what's in it for them? They're going to get a return. Now, when we get this money, that money will allow us to fund the bank, which is amazing. What's in it for the government? Then the government will be able to give loans out to for projects. And those projects are roads and affordable housing and railroads and telecommunication, our health system, our water system, and the list goes on and on and on. So what's in it for the developers and the people who are getting these particular loans? They're able to create jobs, hire people, build the infrastructure that our country needs. And the last one, just from the regular consumer, is quality of life. So what's in it for the regular consumer? It's quality of life. If you have kids, your kids can go to schools, right? Many of our schools are dilapidated. We all have a home, whether it's an apartment or we live in a house. Water is in there. We are growing. The economy is growing. More and more people are having more and more children, and our wiser people are living longer. So we need to make sure that we have infrastructure, i.e. affordable housing, so that our seniors can stay in their homes and that generational wealth that they have built can be passed on from generation to generation. And then jobs. We need jobs. We need a whole lot of jobs. So this bank, this National Infrastructure Bank that I'm a co-sponsor on AR 158, we introduced it and we want to continue to just push the federal government to pass this piece of legislation. It's for all of us. So when all the federal Congress people and senators, when they're looking at this, they should ask themselves that question, what's in it for me? And when they ask themselves that question, then they will think of their children, their grandchildren, and so forth. And they will hit that yes button so that this bill can go over to the president for signature. And the state of New Jersey, I'm on a few bills for infrastructure. I'm on the AR 153, which recognizes and honors critical energy and utility infrastructure workforce for serving during COVID-19 pandemic and other recent extreme weather events. I'm also on A4687, which requires the DEP to prioritize funding for certain projects for acquisition of lands, for recreation and conservation purposes, and certain environmental infrastructure projects that include our flood migration project. I'm also on 4066, which appropriates funds to DEP for environmental infrastructure projects for FY 2023. And I'm also on 4833, which amends the list of projects eligible to receive loans for environmental infrastructure projects from New Jersey Infrastructure Bank list of FY 2023. Greg hit it on the nose when he said the discretionary funding. There's not a lot of discretionary funding for all the municipalities, all the states to go after. It's very, very competitive. But if we have this bank where you can get a loan and we don't have to go to the American people to increase our taxes, because we can't keep taxing the American people. But we have a private sector who has funding, and they will be able to fund this bank and they will get their return. But in return, what's in it for me, I will have a better quality of life. My children, your grandchildren. We can't keep taxing the American people to fix our issues. We have to look at multiple streams to fix our system. So I'm in support of this bill. I will work my hardest in the state of New Jersey to make sure that I continuously fight so that we can have this national infrastructure bank. And I look forward to being on, and at the end, I'll answer some questions. But I want to thank you for allowing me a few minutes to talk about this particular important initiative. And thank you so much for everyone who's on this call tonight, because we could be asleep or watching our favorite TV show, but we're here because we know that this piece of legislation is so, so very important. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Assemblywoman McKnight. We really appreciate your being here and speaking with us on how you viewed the infrastructure bank. Next, I would like to go with a couple of New Yorkers that we have on the line. First, we have with us the former Assistant Speaker of the New York Assembly, Felix Ortiz. Felix?
Thank you. Thank you very much, and Happy New Year to everyone. And it gives me a great pleasure to be with all of you tonight. I hope that you can hear me. And I am, I think the Assemblywoman was right. Some of us might be able to be in a party. Some of us might be able to be watching TV. I am in a party celebrating the Chinese New Year, and I had to get out of here very quick. But anyway, in another note, I would like to really thank Arbeca, and as well as Stuart and all the team that has managed to reach out to all the legislators in New York State. I am very happy that my ban is done. I've been in some of the phone calls encouraging my former colleagues to do three things. Number one, for those of the members who belong to the Black Caucus and the Hispanic Caucus, to allow us, Alveca and some of us, to really brief them on the importances of the resolution. Number two, asking members to encourage them to hold press conferences and calling on Congress, especially their own delegation in New York State, who has been, some of the members has been very incredible to support the bill and also to listen to us, including the minority speaker of the House, Hakeem Jeffries. So his staff has been in touch with us, and I am very pleased that Hakeem is a friend. We serve together in the New York State Assembly. We live only a few blocks away from each other, and I hope that we'll be able to galvanize support in Congress on a bipartisan way that this resolution finally will come to fruition. Lastly, I will say that, lastly is that I will encourage every single one of the members who are new on this call, and for those of us who have been here day after day, year after year, and month after month, to encourage their colleagues in their own assembly and Senate, respectively, to hold up a press conference, on calling on the member of Congress and the US Senate to jump to this important legislation. The Assemblywoman McKnight was talking about no more taxes. Well, the only reason why 5 years ago I decided to introduce this resolution in the New York State Assembly, being the first legislator in the country, was because it is addressed that. No more taxes for our children, our grandchildren, and great-grandchildren. If you look to the back bill that was passed in Congress, that bill is a sin tax to our, not just our great-grandchildren, but to us, including ourselves, as we speak right now, as this bill begins to mobilize and move forward. So I think it's imperative that we, those members who are still elected and we who are continuing to advocate and support this resolution, that will encourage our state legislators who are so critical and so important, not only within redistrict comp, but in the budget, when they have to negotiate the budget and when they call into the Congress to make sure that this resolution is very simple. Affordable housing, no taxes, broadband, opportunity for minority folks to empower themselves to also be in charge of some of the important jobs that will come out of this resolution. Not just to be like we always be the subcontractor, but to be the main contractor and main employers. And this is resolution address that. That is the reason why I'm supporting this. Again, I am encouraging every new member who are in this call today to please go back and Assemblywoman McKnight hit it right on it. I think it's important to galvanize that support to a state by state holding press conferences. And I might want to add this, but it's not part of my scripts. We might going to call for a day of action where we throughout the 50th state and the territory might be able to have galvanized for the legislator to hold a press conference unilaterally to call in Congress to do this. And we don't have no time to waste anymore. I think it's about time that we do what is right. So thank you very much. I had to go back to do Gonghe Fa Choi, which has been Happy New Year in Chinese. And I had to continue with my friend who support me for many years. And they just invited me to be part of them. So thank you very much. And I'm glad to be part of this wonderful family to continue to fight back.
Thank you, Felix. We can always rely on you for a spirited, talk for our folks here. Next, I'm going to put somebody on the spot who didn't know he was going to be called on, but that is Assemblyman Anderson from New York. He sort of logged into the call anonymously and didn't put his name down, but we know who you are.
Oh, yeah, I'm in here. Hold on. Okay, can you see me? Can you hear me?
Yes, thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. So hi, good evening, everybody. Thank you so much. It's good to see former Assemblymember Ortiz. I'm so glad that he's on the call this evening. I did not have the privilege of serving with him, but thank you for your work. So I am Khalil Anderson. I represent the 31st Assembly District in Southeast Queens in New York City. If you've ever flown to JFK Airport, you certainly have been to my Assembly District. I'm so excited, and I hope to actually get to connect with Assemblywoman McKnight, from our sister state, New Jersey, across the water, because this issue around infrastructure banks, this issue around making sure that we have MWBEs in every single construction project that runs through this bank is critical to me, and I'm looking forward to looking at ways to address our state's infrastructure needs and our state's commitment to building and expanding the concept of an infrastructure bank. I currently serve as the chair on the subcommittee for banks and underserved communities. And this infrastructure bank will certainly serve underserved communities in that it would help put more people back to work, hire hard to employ folks, but also help develop more individuals in the skilled trades, which is so important and critical. And so I'm looking forward to figuring out how we could get New York on board. So I'm in talks with you all about how we can pull New York in on this. I know that 24 states have introduced resolutions, and we certainly want to make sure that New York continues that trend and pushes the federal government to do the right thing and create this federal bank, federal infrastructure bank. But separate from that, I'm a big advocate for public banks, as you can imagine, because there are so many financial institutions that do not lend to Black and brown communities or do not lend to those who struggle with credit issues. And that's a concept and a reality for many families across this state, city, and nation. So I'm looking forward to the work that you all are doing. I'm always ready to speak and chat. This is something I'm newly passionate about, and I look forward to creating opportunities to make sure New York is on the list. Thank you so much, Julie.
Hey, thank you, Assemblyman Anderson. Really appreciate it. So with that, I would like to open the floor for questions and answers and comments. And if you do have a question, please raise your hand. And I would like to start out with a question for Dr. Prins. And I'm wondering if you could talk about how investing in infrastructure would transform our economy versus the areas where our economy is invested now. Dr. Prins?
Thank you, Julie. The thing is, we, because of the availability of trillions of dollars of cheap money over the years, particularly since financial crisis, a lot of that money has gone into more speculative endeavors and financial assets. The difference in terms of longer term investing in infrastructure is that at the end of the day, you have something permanent that is going to be around for the economy from that point forward. It's not the same thing if you invest in some speculative stock or financial asset. That can go up or down, but once you have a solid bridge, once you fix a better highway, once you create high-speed rail that works, once you transform and bring in workers along the way. It's very interesting what Greg was saying in terms of how many workers we actually need to do all this work. But once you basically create a stronger infrastructure-oriented workforce as well, and you kind of expand upon that, then we have a permanence in terms of what we produce and what we can use and how we can utilize it to move the economy forward. And just as one example of many things, this happened before the before FDR, but in sort of wake into it and between Hoover and FDR, was the Hoover Dam. I mean, that was constructed effectively during a Great Depression. And this was after the Fed had been created to ostensibly avoid things like Great Depressions and financial crises. That lasts. That is there. That is there. It's immense. It's one of many, many things that we've been able to create as a country when we focus on infrastructure, energy-oriented infrastructure, and we're able to see it decades and decades and decades after and potentially centuries after it's built. That's the difference. It's long-lasting economic investment versus short-term speculative betting.
Thank you for that explanation, Nomi. That was great. I see we've got quite a few hands up here in the audience, so we will start with Philip Strabe. Philip, do you have a comment or a question?
I had to unmute first. Actually, a couple of comments and a couple of questions. Earlier, Angela was talking about affordable housing. Kind of begs the question, I think, of what is considered affordable and to whom? And the reason I ask that question is because contractors who build housing are in business to make money. So who will determine how much money they can make versus how much money should be spent on the housing itself? I guess the big question is, what's considered affordable housing?
Well, I'm just going to weigh in there briefly to say that, in my opinion, one of the best things about a national infrastructure bank is that it is going to be driven by the loan packages that are put in by local communities. So it's going to allow those local communities self-determination to determine what they feel is the type of housing that they need. And so it's going to give those local communities a huge amount of control over the types of loans and infrastructure financing they apply for. I don't know, Alfeka, can you maybe add to that, or what's your take on that?
Great. Thank you very much for that great question. In fact, I heard it on an earlier Zoom call, and it prompted me to make a suggestion for an improvement in the bill that's in drafting right now. So added into the bill is a new definition of what is affordable housing. And it's now defined as housing that goes towards any family that is already paying above one third of its family income on housing, which is way too much, above a third. And also the family income is below 40% of the average median income. And that's what the housing insecurity folks tell us, the low income housing folks tell us is needed as the definition to make sure we get these resources to the very families who need them the most. And then in terms of how we formulate out a housing project in a local area, there's all kinds of different patterns that might take, and it needs a big discussion. We need a new paradigm for affordable housing in the United United States. They have some very successful models in other countries, but leaving this up to the private sector and real estate developers to come up with affordable housing has not been working. And that's why we really need to focus this bank critically on how we deliver affordable housing.
Thanks, Alfeka. Philip, did you have another question?
Kind of a follow-up to that commentary. In the capitalistic society we live in, the prices of housing, I would think, is based on the availability of the housing. If there is more housing available, I would think the market would automatically drive the prices down, to a certain point at least. I just wanted to add that comment. My other issue was high-speed rail was mentioned. And while I agree that we need more and better rail in this country, both on the freight and passenger side, so much of it has been lost since the 1950s. If we were to ask somebody in the 50s how much rail is in this country, the answer would be somewhere close to 250,000 miles, 250,000 miles. Today, it's about 120,000 miles. It's gotten a little bit skeletal. And it's one of the reasons why passenger rail is suffering as it is, because there's really no place to put the trains. On that line, and no pun intended when I say on that line, high-speed rail, while desirable, is expensive, especially here where so much money would have to be spent to alleviate the problem associated with trespassing. People getting killed today on just what we might consider regular speed rail would be exacerbated if we were to go high speed. And for that matter, the money spent on just one rail line could be better spent just putting more schedules, more trains on the current lines and maybe increasing them to an actual system of passenger rail rather than the skeletal system we have. Having said that, just one more comment. Short-term versus long-term, it used to be in this country, companies would invest for the long-term. Susquehanna Railroad Bridge over near Harrisburg, Pennsylvania is a perfect example of that. If we were to build that today, the investors on the rail line would expect an immediate return in the next quarter or two. Railroads didn't think that way back in the 1900s. They built for permanence. I think that's one of the things we are lacking in this country today with every company, not just rail, is the idea of investing for the future, not just for the immediate future, but long-term future.
Hey, thank you for those comments, Philip. Just speaking for myself, I do believe that the way we view some of those aspects of capitalism is slowly changing, so that we're putting some emphasis back on the corporation's relationship to the community it operates in, their customers, their employees, and that sort of thing. And I do want to say, if you were to look back at some of our previous webinars, we've had experts on talking about high-speed rail and the economic justification for high-speed rail. So I think things have changed quite a bit in terms of the cost justification for putting in high-speed rail. And in fact, there are very active groups around the country that are pushing high-speed rail in many locations. But we can, I would suggest perhaps viewing another one of our previous videos on that topic. And we have a lot of questions, so I would like to move on. We'll go with Alex from Denver, Colorado. Alec from Denver, yes. Colorado.
Yes, hello. Thank Hi. You for these wonderful presentations. Two things for me. One is there was quite a bit of talk about growth and looking at growth as a good thing. It seems to me that with the work of Herman Daly and Kenneth Boulding and in steady state economics, we can't grow anymore. This is a problem that FDR, of course, did not have, whereas we do have that issue. The second one is with respect to jobs. FDR had the advantage of a whole host of people that, who are unemployed, and so therefore there was no difficulty in hiring them and training them in order to do this work. We are very, even though there is indeed a danger of a recession, if not a great recession, we still have pretty high employment. And so therefore, we would have the difficulty of hiring people. And also not yet a word about robots and artificial intelligence.
Well, we only have an hour to do our presentations, Alex. So we're, you know, somewhat limited on hitting all of them. But I do want to turn to our economists, Alfeka and Nomi, for an answer on the growth question. Should we expect to continually have growth in our country? Either one. No, Alfeka, Nomi?
Yeah, I could start out and then Nomi can pick up, I'm sure. We are now at a world population of 8 billion people. If we don't grow, we can't feed our people and we'll essentially starve to death. So it's not really an option. We need to grow productively and we need to pull in all these things that you're mentioning, robotics, retraining our work, reshifting our workforce and reapplying them in more productive ways than they are right now. Even though we have very low unemployment, we also have very low productivity. So all these things need to be worked at. And so we need to grow smartly. And in addition, we need to hire people and retrain them for great jobs, because the jobs that they're in right now, they're not earning a family sustaining wage. Robert Reich, our former Secretary of the Labor, said we don't really have a labor shortage. If you pay people more, a family sustaining wage for their work, and we will hire them that way to do this kind of work for the National Infrastructure Bank, they will absolutely come. So we need a really reshifting and refurbishing of our economy and bringing ourselves up into 21st century technologies. And there's lots of things that we can do to grow productively. Thanks. Nomi?
Yeah, no, I agree, unsurprisingly, with a lot of what Alfeka just said. And also just to, you know, tie into how we grow in terms of the technological advances, whether they are in agriculture to feed people, whether they are in battery technology to harness power in order to develop other forms of infrastructure along the way. So I think the balance of what we do in AI, what we do in robotics, and also how we do look at the workforce and incentivize people. I think there was more of a pride in terms of construction, engineering, and other forms of work in the 40s and 50s and 60s, you know, anywhere from the highways to the space program, in terms of physically creating as well as technologically advancing different forms of infrastructure and energy and power and everything else. And I think that still exists, not just in our country, but in the world. And I think it's necessary as a part of going back to why we're here, the National Infrastructure Bank, that we do look across, you know, having the funding, having the long-term funding to find the best solution to that growth. And that includes different forms of workers, different forms of technologies, and sort of the melding of them together as we grow. And it grow is yes, a very broad term. And we talk about it as a way to basically, I think, look at how we can fund the transformation of our economy as well. So it's growing into the future. It's moving forward as opposed to just sort of getting bigger or whatever that sounds like from a broad aspect. We're actually transforming our economy as we move along.
Thank you, Nomi. Okay, we're going to go back to our audience for questions. And I do want to ask people to keep your comments brief, as we do want to try to give everyone an opportunity to ask a question. So our next person we're going to is Maud, who I believe is representing the League of Women Voters.
Yes, thank you. League of Women Voters of Colorado. Building affordable housing for families with income below 40% of area median income is a very noble cause. These people, of course, are very, very low income. They pay very little tax. The bank gives out loans, I'm understanding, to build the affordable housing. I don't quite understand what the mechanism is to get the funding to repay the loans, assuming the loans have to be repaid.
Alfeka, you were nodding your head. Would you like to address that briefly?
Sure. When I mentioned that we need a new paradigm for how we roll out affordable housing, that's going to have to include a cross-subsidization stream to support this affordable housing. It's not just enough to lend to physically build affordable housing buildings or, you know, more dense apartment buildings or something like that. But we need, in addition, a stream and a mechanism to finance it. There's all kinds of really great models. The one that I really like is the model of Austria, Vienna, Austria, where they have implemented a real estate tax to fund the low-income housing, which they provide to 50% of their city residents. 50% of their city residents live in affordable housing. And that pushes down the rents for everybody in the city and actually offsets the cost of this additional real estate tax. So there's all kinds of models and ways that we can do this. And we need to really think intelligently about this because there's huge social cost to the disruption from housing insecurity. When people get out onto the streets, they can't work, they can't get healthcare facilities, they wind up going on Medicaid, they wind up getting on unemployment insurance. There's all kinds of extra costs that are associated with housing insecurity. And so there'll be a plus benefit to everybody's budget and every community. And what we found is that even if localities who don't want to allow affordable housing in their area, they don't want to give the zoning permits, they don't like it being next to them, it actually raises their property values. And when we do all of that, then we're going to be bringing in more resources into governments, into local governments, to pay back and cross-subsidize this affordable housing. We'll have to think really carefully about how we can do it.
Thanks. Julie, can I add something to that, Julie?
One moment, please. I do want to point out that a public bank does not have to make a profit. So unlike housing developers, unlike commercial banks, the National Infrastructure Bank would not have to make a profit.
So when we talk about the different methods of, you know, building affordable housing, I'll talk about one project here in Jersey City, New Jersey. It's a mixed use. So on a front level, the first level, it's commercial. So you can have companies who come in there and then they can, you know, pay rent. Then they have market rate. So people who have market rate, they can pay. Then this particular project has very low income and low income. So they have created a model where the building will be mixed use. And we need to make sure that we have all different people living together because we're all in, you know, in a community. So you have brick and mortars there, low income, low income, and then market rate income. So that's a way where we can actually pay back the loan when we get it from the bank. So I just wanted to point that out. That's one of many methods that a developer can use.
Thank you, Angela. That was a great example. And I was wanting to go to Ellen Brown and to pull her into this discussion. I also think that we maybe have not mentioned the use of infrastructure banks around the globe and how other countries are doing this, although Alfeka did mention Austria. Ellen, do you have any comments to add on this topic? You're muted.
You mentioned that it doesn't have to be a profitable, I mean, it's a nonprofit bank, but we still have to come up with the 2% over the bond. I mean, there, you know, you do need some profit, but it's true that we can return any profits to the community. That's the whole idea of public banking. And we cut out the middlemen pretty much, and the big expensive investors and the expensive CEOs, that kind of stuff. So it is a lot cheaper than a regular private bank.
Thank you, Ellen. Appreciate that. Okay, we're going to go to our next person from the audience, and that would be Bonnie Sundance. Bonnie, you've got your hand up. Do you have a question or a comment?
Yes, thank you. So I have several concerns. One is that I would really like to see a movement of transforming our economy in which businesses have to first serve the public good and that profit is not the primary motive. Second concern is that we cannot keep growing without regard for our relationship to the earth herself and thinking that we can just keep take from the earth. And the Colorado River problems are a primary example of that. We need to learn to live smarter, particularly in the state I'm in Colorado, in relationship to water. People, you know, if wanting to have a green lawn in the state of Colorado is an absurdity. And so there are a lot of pieces that I believe the American public need to really make an effort to learn about the earth, and particularly learning from indigenous people who successfully lived here before colonial people invaded. Thank you.
Thanks, Bonnie. Your points are well taken. And you know, sometimes it seems like change happens very slowly, and then we get a lot of change all at once. And that's really kind of one of the things that we're hoping to have happen here with National Infrastructure Bank. Okay, I would like to go with Glenn Rehing.
Hi, right. Thank you. Very informative. I appreciate your time. My question is this. From a developer standpoint, if I'm doing like from the ground up, if I'm participating in the infrastructure bank at the local level, there seems to be a lot of information out there, but it doesn't seem like there's a funnel that will kind of handhold people that have not had any experience to do, that has never done a project using the infrastructure bank, like in Ohio or that. I was wondering, what would be a good outline for people like me, who's never had any experience of this, where to start?
Well, I think what we're gonna do is turn to our expert on infrastructure financing, Greg Seeley. Greg, can you address Glenn's question?
Yeah, you bet. Thank you. And it's a good point. You know, I'll just say this for folks who are trying to do community development as just citizens and advocates, you have an especially high hill to climb there to try to access this information. And there, but even at the local government level, there is not a ton of proactive outreach from the federal and or state government down to local governments to say, hey, we want to get some of this money out to you. What do you guys need to deploy this money? That doesn't happen. In fact, I have to send my mayor out to DC to meet with high-level folks at Department of Transportation and HUD and put together all these one-pagers and stuff so that we can advocate on our behalf to try to secure some of this money, right? So it's actually quite the opposite direction it should be, right? And so I think one of the problems the National Infrastructure Bank solves is that it gives you a long-term cohort of professionals who do this work on a regular basis and can proactively be based right there in their community. You can think of them as regional hubs and regional centers for this work. They'll know the community needs, and you can go directly to your community office and work with that National Infrastructure Bank who has professionals that are working year over year on these issues, as opposed to somebody who's just jumping into this for a few years to catch this level of funding and then moving to something completely different when the temperature changes in a couple of years. I hope that makes sense.
Thank you, Greg. That was a great answer. Now, I want to interject here and ask our IT person to put up our slide, our letter to the editor that we recently saw published in the Toledo Blade. And let's see, is this the right one? Maybe this is not the right one. I wanted the one with the video and moving water to Colorado. There it is, that one. Okay, so you know, we're calling 2023 the year of the National Infrastructure Bank. And one of the projects that we've had a huge amount of interest in is building a pipeline that would actually take water from the Mississippi River area and move it over to Colorado. And we are so fortunate to have one of the main proponents of this plan on our call, and he's actually got his hand up. So what I would like to do is go to Don Sifkis, and he actually had an op-ed in, was it USA Today? And he and Alfeca have gotten a lot of press on this idea. So Don, you got your hand up. Did you have a question or a comment?
Well, I'm not going to talk about the water thing tonight. But it certainly can be done and should be done, and the bank can finance it. So I totally 100% support that. One comment, the civilian labor force in the United States is around 160 million people. The labor participation rate is around 62%. So whatever 8% 60 million people available to work, I don't think having people is a problem. Question, I'm gonna make sure, I wanna get copies of Ellen Brown, Greg Seeley, and Nomi Prins's PowerPoints. Are they gonna be up on the website? I need to study those. In 6 or 7 minutes, I can't grasp it all. Those are fantastic PowerPoints, chock full of information. Every single congressman and senator should be forced to read those things. I don't know how to do that. There's a lot of preaching to the choir here. I mean that in a good sense, but we need to get more preaching to people that can vote. So how do we get copies of those PowerPoints?
Angela Bulo, what do you think?
They will be up on the website within 48 hours.
Okay, awesome. Thank you, Don.
Okay, great.
Thank you, appreciate it. Okay, next we're gonna go with Joe Polito. Joe, you've got your hand up. Do you have a question or a comment?
I do. The gentleman referred to on the telephone link to the housing market, and he sort of misled us in that he made it sound as if the housing market worked, and it's the most dysfunctional and maybe most important market in the country. And Elfeca did a great job on that, as she did on her initial presentation. I just like to say, housing is the most rigged market by the rentiers, who Kane said that we should euthanize. Everything is set up to make the land appreciate. And there are lots of good economic techniques, which Elfeca could probably tell us more about, which could capture all of that unearned income. There are taxes, there are changes to capital gains for commercial real estate. There's good rent control systems. There's the kind of regulation she suggested. There's all sorts of things that we need to do to make the housing market work. I'm in Canada, it's even worse. That's something that unfortunately the public bank by itself won't fix. Otherwise, the rentiers will just capture a lot of the money that the public bank will put into the economy. It's a massive wealth transfer system. I think Mazzucato calls it a wealth transfer system, and it needs to be fixed. Thanks very much.
Thank you for your comments, Joe. And next, I'd like to go with Barbara Muser.
A land value tax would.
Yes. Yes.
Thank you, Ellen. Okay, Barbara, did you have a question?
Yes, I do. Thank you for letting me speak. This is for Ellen or whoever would like to answer this. I'm following the central bank digital currency that is now being more and more in our news. And I was just reading an article in the Wall Street Journal on the 16th of January. Talking about the central bank digital currency and how the Biden White House in September said it was outlining the possibilities of this. And I wanted to find out from Ellen and anyone else how this would impact any kind of public bank, and how, if the public bank is outside of the Federal Reserve, and how regular currency and monetary value would be retained, even though other banks, the corporate banking system, would actually implement CBDCs. So if I could get that question, I'd really be grateful to get your perspective on that. Thank you.
Yeah, well, thanks. My own perspective, from what I've read, it looks to me like my guess is that the Fed is not going to do a CBDC to individuals. I mean, what they're talking about is where it's an international thing where they, you know, they're connecting with other central banks. But it sounds to me like Jerome Powell is opposed, for one thing. And I've seen a lot of people talking about how difficult it would be to implement. But Nomi probably has better ideas than I do on that. Nomi?
Yeah, well, I think at some point, the Federal Reserve is looking at what's happening in terms of digital and crypto, has been for years, you know, has programmers, analysts, the whole thing sort of teed up in developing in this area. It's just another way to move forward, really, the ability to, you know, sort of to create money when it's needed. I mean, right now, basically, it's an electronic process that's predicated on the US dollar. A digital currency would also be predicated on the US dollar, but with the Fed effectively working more closely at sort of the currency aspect of that through the banking system. And right now, actually, the Federal Reserve is working with one of its reserve banks, the Seattle Bank, which is working on something called FedNow, to just look at like the logistics and sort of how the implementation would actually work. And I think from the standpoint of actually individuals, it's going to be some time before your bank gives you the option of using a CBDC or not. There's going to be like test banks. It's going to be a process, I think, that will take some evolution. I think ultimately, you know, as Ellen said, it's going to work in a way that the Federal Reserve is going to be using another form of currency backed by the digital dollar that, yes, they can use in international exchange. They can use in swaps. They can use when we have a crisis. And have sort of more control over it than necessarily going through the banks, but still working with the banks. And so I think it's a ways off in terms of the National Infrastructure Bank, where I don't think that's going to come into play in the near future, is because, again, we're going to fund it and leverage that funding from existing and already issued Treasury securities. And so where the funding comes relative to that is where we care about. And I think it's going to be a long while before we have to worry about that being in CBDC versus sort of the current dollar system that we have. And that's also because the Fed doesn't work that quickly, except when it's raising rates.
Okay, thank you, Nomi. Appreciate that. Thank you. Okay, we are going to go to the middle of the country, Ohio. We have on the line a former candidate for Congress in Ohio who spent quite a few months traversing rural areas of Ohio. Craig, did you have a question or comment this evening?
Just a couple of comments. I really liked what Greg Seeley had to say about the competitive grant business. As a city councilman here in Upper Sandusky, small locality, we had to rely on the experts to come in and help get those competitive grants. And a lot of times we were very unsuccessful. And when we were successful, you're paying out tens of thousands of dollars to these guys. So a lot of the percentage of the grant that you do win does go over for administrative or just for company, or the council part of it. The other thing too is, on a personal note, I have my father-in-law here in a assisted living. He's paying $7,000 a month. And here's a guy that's making $40,000 a year. He's ambulatory. He's with it. And he's used it for rehab. And we have no affordable housing in this community. It's either HUD-based or tax credit-based, which Ohio just got rid of. So the developers are in a bit of a fix about that one. And so he's priced out of any kind of apartments that we have. We have no availability of apartments for somebody that is over that income threshold. Lorraine, here's another thing that happened in my district. Lorraine just purchased the Midway Mall, Lorraine County, the Port Authority there. They have no idea what they're going to do with it. This is something I always talked about with a public bank, which you could take these properties and convert them into full-time year-round farmers markets. You take some of that parking lot space, you convert it into greenhouses, solar power it, and now you're providing fresh produce for your hospitals, your schools, your neighborhoods, your restaurants, everything. And it's all about the food security that we've got to be taken care of. So I really appreciate a lot of the people that were speaking tonight and the areas that we're touching upon, because it affects so many of us personally across this country. Thank you.
Thanks, Craig. Appreciate it. Okay, Rochelle Asher, do you have a quick question or comment?
Well, it's actually her husband, John. But thank you.
Okay.
Quick question. This I know I would probably ask Alfeca separately, but I thought I would ask it, which is that, Alfeca, in terms of the capitalization of the bank, would the bank be able to, in a sense, entice the Treasury bills that are out there for the capitalization of the bank, which are out there at a lower rate, or how would the bank actually set the payment of the interest rates given the current environment of treasury rates going up. So it's kind of like, is there an opportunity for the bank to say, okay, we need $500 billion. There's a lot of that debt out there, which is, you know, sitting there at very low rates. You know, we can get that low rate, say we can spend, you know, pay 2% more. Is that the way the capitalization would work?
So you are correct, John, that the market, the treasury market is changing right now. The rates are all overall rising. And when each treasury that's owned by a private holder expires at the end of its maturity, then it will likely be turned over, rolled over into a new treasury that's going to capture a higher rate. So altogether, the rates are rising. And when we say that we're going to pay up to 2% above that, whatever that treasury rate is that the private holder would be selling into the NIB, the board actually, it's not a hard 2%. The board could has a flexibility to do it anywhere from 0.5% up to 2%, depending on what the market will bear. So the board will have to decide what it needs to set to attract to get these rates in. But it's still very much the case that private holders, including, for example, pension funds, the fourth largest holder of treasuries happens to be the U.S. Postal Service pension fund workers. It's still the case that whatever they're holding, whether it's an old treasury at a lower rate or they're rolling it over into a higher treasury at a newer rate, it's still the case that that pension fund must rely on holding treasuries because it's required to hold a AAA secure security. As those rates rise, it's still the case that they would be very attracted to get even a little bit more above whatever kind of paper they're holding. And so that they would be very interested in just getting a better return on their portfolio to make sure they have enough sufficient adequate resources in their pension fund to pay pensioners, you know, years out in into the future. They need to increase their rate of yield on their pension funds, and they're very interested in getting this extra rate, whatever it's going to be.
Thanks, Alfeka. And we have one final question, and that would be from Julie Stackhouse.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for the time tonight. So just so you know, I'm a member of the League of Women Voters of Larimer County, Colorado. I'm also the retired executive vice president of the Federal Reserve Bank of St. Louis. So I understand the Federal Reserve very, very well. And I might take some exception to some comments made tonight, but I'll leave those as it is. I'll offer just two comments, one on central bank digital currencies for the previous commenter. Central bank digital currencies is a complicated subject because the Fed has no interest in reducing the amazing banking system we have in the United States with some 5,000 commercial banks and another 5,000 credit unions. It provides credit in a way that other countries envy. So I think if the Fed does pursue a CBDC, it will be for wholesale purposes, basically to reduce the cost of inter-country transfers, the cost of those, which is right now largely expensive. But even that has a lot of complexities because different governments are offering different digital currencies. So enough said on that. The other thing I would offer, and it's really just for the people who are supporting this concept, is I think the piece that is a little bit vague, as described tonight, is whether or not you're proposing this infrastructure bank to be really government-backed, or if it is sort of a government-sponsored enterprise, because that will determine the cost of funds for the proposal that you have at hand. And I think there's a real uncertainty after the housing crisis about government-sponsored enterprises, or GSEs as we call them, these vague things that stand between government and private sector, and whether or not they make sense for investors. If indeed you are asking for something that's government sponsored, then I think we have to look at this through the lens of what is the fiscal impact, the potential impact government debt. I think that's a responsible thing to do. And you know, from there, the hard question that I really push you to think about is, are we trying to go around the intent of Congress? And I'm not saying that to be controversial here tonight at all. I'm just simply saying that we have a way of government in the United States, whether we like it or not sometimes, that imposes a structure upon U.S. citizens. So I only offer that. I think that that use case needs to be better explained of whether or not what we are doing is really intended. I know it's for the betterment. The intent is for the betterment. But does it work around the intent of Congress? And I'd encourage you to think of a stronger statement in that regard. So I'll leave it at that. And I hope that little bit of information gives you some food for thought.
That was very interesting. I do want to point out that when a national infrastructure bank is created, it will be created by Congress. So our goal, we feel, is to encourage our Congress people who represent us to create a national infrastructure bank so that we can use it for the betterment of the American economy and to restore our competitiveness as a country. Other countries around the world, let's talk about China, use infrastructure banks. And the US is falling behind because we have not implemented this tool that some of our major competitors around the world are using. But Alfeka, I would like to go to you to address Julie's other point.
So thank you very much for those great comments, Julie. I really appreciate it. The National Infrastructure Bank, as it's currently drafted, is enacted under the US Government Corporations Act. And it is a wholly owned entity of the United States government, even though it is capitalized in this Hamiltonian method using existing treasury. So it is wholly owned by the government. It does have government guarantees to it. However, we think that infrastructure lending is a very secure business. All the loans of the four previous banks that we've had were all paid back. They went into very viable projects like the Tennessee Valley Authority, like the Transcontinental Railroad, very transformative. Our first industrial centers in Paterson, New Jersey were built with the First Bank of the United States. And this concept of a public bank to promote the general welfare actually went all the way up to the Supreme Court in a kind of a dither over it. And the Supreme Court determined that it fits within the parameters of the US Constitution to have entities like this that promote the general welfare. And we very much want to make sure that these projects roll out well, that we can reduce costs, that they are all for the public benefit. And we've seen the transformative ways that public banks were used four times in our nation's past. They were very successful. It's a tried and true system. We cannot, the reality is, we cannot fund infrastructure through the federal budget or through state and local budgets or even through the bond market. It's not been working. We've tried it for the last 70 years and our spending as a percent of GDP has gone down and down and down, and we've fallen way behind our competitors. Just see what China has done with three banks like this. Built out high-speed rail, transformed their economies, brought them out of poverty, a billion people out of poverty, built a complete water grid all across their country with transformative banks like this. And so we absolutely need one. We can't rely. Infrastructure needs a long-term source, steady source of funding, as our representative from Albuquerque has mentioned. And this bank will provide it, and we'll be able to make sure that we're not at the vagaries of the budget and going back every year and asking for money. And we saw what happens when you have a flush of money in this five-year bipartisan law that we can't even kind of digest it. We need a steady state stream of financing for infrastructure, and we need technological expertise behind it so that we develop it well.
Thanks, Alfeka.
And if I might, Julie, just to add a thought, we have an incredible financial system in the United States, federally insured, which Correct. Means the banks pay the premiums.
Correct.
If what you want is to push more money into infrastructure, I push it into the banking system rather than establish a separate entity, because I think creditworthiness is kind of hard to judge. And I think you've got an entity already in existence or entities already in existence.
But I would ask the contrary question. Why hasn't the banking system lent for infrastructure? It could have done it through the bond market, but it hasn't done it because it would rather, I would agree with those you know, critics of the banking system that would say where we've pushed our money over the last 20 years has been into compiling derivatives, causing financial instruments, and not pushing it into the real market. Why haven't we pushed it into the real market? Because a lot of our manufacturing has been offshored, and we don't really even have a market in the United States to buy these goods. So the financing is not going there, either to infrastructure or into investments in companies that would build up their productive base. That's not happening. So we really need a way to mobilize and steer this financing into this infrastructure area, which will be the most productive kind of investment that government can make.
And also, just to add on to that, the large banks that are privy to the main components of the Federal Reserve System and the alliances in terms of how lending works, how the availability of money works, the window, et cetera, don't have the necessary incentives to work at the local level, at the community level, at the state level, in large scale, foundation up, long-term infrastructure projects, not because they are risky, but because there's other places that are easier to put money.
Yes.
Thank you. Julie Stackhouse, I just want to reiterate how much we value your input. I think it's really important to have these conversations. And we've certainly learned over the course of the past couple of years doing these webinars. So thank you so much for attending and making those comments. Joe, your hand is up.
Thank you. Just wanted to add to Alpeca's great comments that Janet Yellen said during the financial crisis that it was a Minsky moment. We all know how Minsky felt about the private banking system and Friedman even. The Reconstruction Bank was a great precedent, which did so much. The private banks are for profit, and sometimes things that are really good for the people aren't profitable. Mm-hmm. And the public bank solves that conundrum. Thanks very much.
Thanks, Joe. And then for our final comment of the evening, we're going to go to Maud Narol. Maud?
Thank you. we have an infrastructure funding system for state and local government in this country, which is highly subsidized. Interest on municipal bonds are free, are not taxed. There's no federal tax on them. And if you're living in the state where the bond was issued, there's no state income tax on them. It's quite a high subsidy. There are trillions of dollars of projects being funded with these bonds. There's already a system for doing this. Yes. And also one of the things was roads. And again, we need a tax base to pay back a loan to the bank for roads, which means probably raising state or local taxes unless we put tolls on all our roads.
Thank you for those comments, Maud. I'd just like to throw out an example from my neck of the woods. And if we look at Seattle has a light rail system that extends both north and south from the airport there in Seattle. And if you were to take that light rail system at every single stop along the way, you would see new private development going in, whether it's apartment buildings, commercial buildings, rehabbing of old homes and that sort of thing. And that private investment and development is going to raise the property taxes along that whole string of light rail, and therefore raise more dollars, more tax dollars for the local community that can then be pledged to pay off an infrastructure loan. So that's just one example. I think Assemblywoman McKnight from New Jersey also brought up a very good example of how public infrastructure can bring along private development that would be able to raise enough money to pay off the loan. Alfeka, did you have any additional comments you'd like to make on that?
You mentioned the municipal bond market. Actually, we did a little 10-page paper on exactly your question. Why haven't the municipal bond market stepped in to fill this infrastructure financing gap? And as a matter of fact, the American Society of Civil Engineers said the investment gap grew from $1.4 trillion back in the 2017 report card up to $2.6 trillion in the current report card. And yet the bond market total provision of loans has remained steady at $4 trillion. It hasn't expanded to fill in that gap. So if the bond market were capable of filling the infrastructure financing gap, it would have done so already. And as to your question of how we finance a local road or a school or anything like that, the big secret of the bank is this going to be this increase in economic growth. We saw it happen with the Reconstruction Finance Corporation, the previous bank, where we got growth up to 5% a year. What we know is that local revenues go down when there's a recession, go up when there's growth again coming out of a recession. And when you have 5% growth, they go up even higher. So we'll be able to capture these new revenues coming in from higher growth in order to pay back all the loans. And we have a pretty careful analysis of how that can happen. But the big secret is economic growth and increased productivity that will come out of these infrastructure investments. And thanks for your great question.
Thanks, Alfaka. Nomi, did you have anything to add to that?
No, I mean, I think that's ultimately what Jonah's tying it together. What we're trying to do is look at where those foundational infrastructure projects are around the country and tie them into long-term capital through a national infrastructure bank that's committed to long-term projects and effectively makes Congress's job kind of amplified but easier, and that it just has to sort of recognize that this is a necessity in order to have that kind of capital moving on a long-term basis into infrastructure projects that transcend the economy from the ground level up, and not have to sort of have budgetary votes or spending horse trading or, you know, just sorts of regular election-oriented, you know, discourse in order to keep those funds flowing and not have, you know, just sort of Greg's presentation, you know, all of this extra work that's done at the local levels to even get a part of that money rather than to just know there's a long-term loan behind it and it's going to effectively work to capitalize a long-term project.
Thanks, Nomi. Greg, do you have any knowledge of the challenges that local communities would face in terms of trying to go to the bond market to raise money?
Yeah, I just was going to very quickly, I tried to find a graph that I came across earlier today and unfortunately just couldn't find it in my bookmarks, but I'll look to add it to that set of slides and the link that we send out. But if you look at the share of funding sources that comes to state and local governments that they can spend on a number of things, infrastructure included, but other items as well, bonds makes up a tiny sliver of that market. Part of the reason for that, and this is just my two cents, I'm not an expert on the bonds side of the house. In fact, my area of focus is federal policy and appropriations, but the bond market is, there are a handful of attorneys and finance specialists in most cities or states, and really only in a few of the bigger cities that actually do that work. And they make very good money by prioritizing bonds for stakeholders that have the interest and aligned priorities to make those things happen. And in fact, my friend who was on the city council before could explain to you probably far better than I could why municipal bonds are actually often quite difficult way to fund these things.
Thank you, Greg. Assemblywoman McKnight, do you have any comments on this topic?
No, just listening and taking it all in. And I do know that we still have more work to be done, but we just have to begin to move the needle.
Yeah. One of the things we envision is that a national infrastructure bank would be able to provide the expertise to both large and small communities that would help them navigate this whole process of getting financing and helping them do the cost justifications and helping them with the engineering studies and that sort of thing. So we really envision sort of a one-stop shopping type of an organization that would really be able to facilitate the whole process, especially for smaller and rural communities who have many challenges and difficulties in getting grants, as we heard from Greg Seeley, and in navigating the bond market. So I think that kind of brings us to the end of our presentation this evening. I want to thank everybody for being here. We do have a couple slides I want to show you. So we just recently had an opinion piece in the Toledo Blade, so one of the very important newspapers in Ohio. So we really appreciate this, the opportunity to bring this issue up before the people of Ohio, and we will help with letters to the editor or opinion pieces that you might be able to submit to the newspaper, the local media in your area. So if this is something you're interested in, please give us a call or send us an email. We are here to help you, and we really want to move this legislation forward all across the country. So we already showed you this. I would encourage everyone to go on our website and sign our petition. And so we've put this petition up here. I'm sure everybody is aware of the severe drought that's affecting the Southwest, the very significant issue of decreasing water levels in our major dams in the Southwest. And we have a solution here in terms of piping water to the Colorado River, and this could be financed with the National Infrastructure Bank. So we'd really like to ask everyone to go to our website, watch the video, and sign our petition. And then while you're on our website, you might take a look at the text of the legislation. We're using the number HR, House Resolution number 3339. That was the number in the last Congress. It will be introduced in this Congress and most likely with a new number. So just be forewarned, when it's introduced in this next upcoming Congress, it will have a new number. But we would really appreciate everyone on the call calling your member of Congress and expressing your support for a national infrastructure bank. Here you have, see the information on the National Infrastructure Bank. We have a website, we have a Facebook page, we have Twitter, we have email, and we have a lot of volunteers that are investing their time and energy into this cause that we believe is gonna make the investment in America that's gonna result in a better economy for the generations to come. And I'd like to take the opportunity to ask everyone that's able to make a donation. It costs money to put on webinars like this one that you've attended this evening. We're doing them about once a month. We'd like to bump that up to twice a month. We've done paid advertising in newspapers and media around the country, very significant advertising, and that costs money also. I know sometimes we have people ask us, why haven't we gotten more attention in Congress? And one of the answers I like to tell people is because we don't have enough money to hire a lobbyist. And I'm sure everybody knows that lobbying is a huge business in Washington, D.C. And if we had some donations, who knows, maybe we could do more lobbying ourselves and develop more support for this National Infrastructure Bank. So thanks again to everyone for attending. We really appreciate it. And please log into our website and get some more details on what it's all about. And we look forward to seeing you on the next call.